Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Judaism Without Tribalism, A Guide to Being a Blessing to All the Peoples of the Earth, by Rami Shapiro. Introduction by Douglas Rushkoff. Narrated by Barry Abrams. Foreword. Douglas Rushkoff. For many people, I suspect, Judaism without tribalism won't sound like Judaism at all. That's because Judaism, at least as my friend Rami Shapiro and I understand it, may best be thought of less as a religion than the way we get over religion. Think about it. Our Torah doesn't tell the story of the founding of a religion. It's about our escape from an empire of slaves controlled by death cults. We are rescued from Egypt, or Mitzrayim, not just the narrow place imprisoning Israelite bodies, but a narrow mindset imprisoning Israelite hearts and souls. And how do we get out of there? The plagues, each of which represents the desecration of another Egyptian god. Blood desecrates the Nile, a god. Locusts desecrate the corn god, and so on, until we get to the ultimate desecration. In April, the Egyptian New Year, when everyone is supposed to be worshiping a ram, what do the Israelites do? Kill a lamb as a sacrifice, an abomination in Egypt, and then put the blood on the door, as if to publicize the fact. Out to the desert we run. For 40 years we walk around out there, not to create a new religion, but to wean ourselves off the need for idols and beliefs and any religiosity at all. The whole generation of believers has to die off. Sure, we build an Ark of the Covenant, and it's pretty much like the Egyptian arks we built before as slaves. But there's one key difference. There is no God up at the top. Rather, there's an empty space guarded by two fierce cherubs. We get no thing to worship, and those cherubs are going to make certain of it. Sure, occasionally we go crazy and try to shove something into that empty space. Moses can't turn his back for a minute before we're crafting a golden calf of one kind or another. And even today, we try to deify silly things like money and power, or even important things like education or Israel. But none of them are gods. No, our deity is so unknowable, unseeable, unnameable, that it may as well not be there at all. That may be the whole point. Judaism invites us to take our gaze off the idealized icon in the sky, however temporarily reassuring, and place it on one another. Yes, we are the real prize here. We people. Our families, communities, friends, neighbors, and even those people over there who we don't quite understand and certainly don't agree with. Living in a tradition like this, as Tevye reminded us, isn't easy. It requires constant improvisation and adaptation to new circumstances, grounded only in the wisdom of the generations that preceded us. Our Talmudic laws may be helpful guideposts, but our morality comes in the moment, spontaneously emerging from our conscience. And this conscience, this moral sensibility, is what we learn from our stories, our community, our experiences, our holidays, and our parents. Judaism without tribalism requires us to abandon the idols and icons, brands and beliefs on which we might prefer to rely as we navigate a course through the strange modern world. But these symbols are not up to the challenge. They're dead, static traps, artifacts of fear and desire, and not at all relevant to lived experience of Jewishness. I've always found it telling that the five books of Torah, the first and most sacred books of the Bible, end before the Israelites make it into Canaan. The story leaves them in the desert, as if to make sure we understand that this is the truest and most essential state of being for a Jew. In between here and there, this and that, the narrow place and the promised land. Always in between, always in motion, always alive, and, if we do it right, always in love. With love, Douglas Rushkoff, New York City. Preface Part 1. Tribe and Tribalism. Tribe. An aggregate of people united by a shared story. Tribalism. Mistaking story as history in service to the elevation of one tribe over all others. Jewish tribalism. The belief that there is one God, creator of heaven and earth, who chose the Jews from among all peoples to be the recipients of his one and only revelation, Torah, and to hold the deed to the promised land in perpetuity. Judaism without tribalism. A system of Jewish teachings and traditions for the training of Jews in service to Teshuvah and Tikkun, respectively, returning to one's true nature as a manifesting of divine aliveness, chiyut, and repairing the world with justice and compassion in fulfillment of the Jews' mission to be a blessing to all the families of the earth. Genesis chapter 12, verse 3. Jews are a tribe, an ancient and fractious family embracing multiple races, ethnicities, languages, customs, cuisines, ideas, and ideals. At the heart of our tribe is the story of Abram and Sarai, who felt called to leave their people, culture, and parents, and to devote themselves to being a blessing to all the families of the earth. Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. Being a blessing to person and planet is what being a Jew is all about, and because we are a tribe, we are always in danger of falling into tribalism, seeing our story as the story and elevating our status above all other tribes on earth. Judaism without tribalism is an attempt to articulate Judaism as a more open, welcoming, and universal path for self-realization, teshuvah, and world repair, tikkun, in service to our original mission of being a blessing. In this way, we open the toolbox of Jewish practice to anyone and everyone. While there is nothing wrong with being a tribe, tribalism is a dangerous perversion of Judaism. Tribalism mistakes story for history, parable for revelation, myth for science, and metaphor for fact. It shifts the focus of Judaism from being a means to an end, being a blessing to all the families of the earth, to being an end unto itself. Jews without tribalism argue over how best to be a blessing. Jews ensnared in tribalism argue over who is a Jew and what is authentic Judaism. Judaism without tribalism is a brief book written in short sections. I invite you to listen to this book and consider its teachings carefully. This is a book to be pondered rather than digested. Its ideas are to be wrestled with rather than accepted. My goal with this book, like my goal for all my Jewish books, is to make Judaism accessible to everyone. I am not concerned with conversion or cultural appropriation. I am concerned with using the language and tools of Judaism to articulate what is universally true. Alles ist Gott. Everything is God. Preface Part 2. What is Judaism without tribalism? Judaism without tribalism is a Judaism rooted in and devoted to two foundational principles, Teshuvah and Tikkun. Returning to your true nature as a manifesting of God and repairing the world with godliness. Judaism without tribalism teaches that God is Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, from the Hebrew verb H-Y-H, to be. The ineffable happening, happening as all happening. Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh is not a noun, but a verb. Not a being, but being itself. Not the creator, but creativity. Not one separate from the many, but a non-dual and endless manifesting of the one and the many. Judaism without tribalism teaches that all life is tohu vavohu, intrinsically fluid, chaotic, absurd, and beyond your willful control. Genesis chapter 1, verse 2. and that each life is hevel, impermanent, empty of any eternal soul, and forever in the process of dying. Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verse 2. You can navigate the chaos, but you cannot manage it. You can push back against the absurdity, but you cannot defeat it. You can make meaning out of mortality, but you cannot escape it. This is not, of course, the teaching of mainstream Judaism. Mainstream Judaism affirms a creator God who orders the universe, endows human beings with individual souls that survive bodily death, chooses the Jews, reveals the nature of things in Torah, and bestows upon his chosen the land of Israel in perpetuity. The Judaism presented in this book is anything but mainstream. The reason for this is simple. Mainstream Judaism doesn't speak to me. My experience of life leads me to reject the notion of an ordered universe functioning according to divine will. My experience leads me to a realization of God beyond tribe, a realization that all reality is the happening of a non-dual process called by many names, Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, Tao, Allah, Godhead, Mother, Brahman, Nature, etc. The Judaism that speaks to me, the Judaism I outline in this book, is rooted in those Jewish texts and teachings that point beyond tribalism toward truths that are not limited to any one tribe, people, or culture, and reflect instead reality as I perceive it. Judaism without tribalism calls you to teshuvah, returning to your true nature as Tzelem Elohim, manifestings of the divine, in the way that waves are manifestings of the ocean that waves them. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. Judaism without tribalism teaches that you are of two minds, mochin dekatnut, the narrow mind of self that is easily given over to yetzer hara, selfishness, and mochin degadlut, the spacious mind of self that is easily given over to selflessness. The goal of Judaism is to place the former in service to the latter. Talmud Berachot 61b. Judaism without tribalism teaches that it isn't good for people to be alone, Genesis chapter 2 verse 18, and that our way is service to the well-being of person and planet. Leviticus chapter 19 verse 18, verse 32, Genesis chapter 3, verse 2. Judaism without tribalism teaches that your mission in life is to be a caretaker of the natural world, Genesis chapter 2 verse 15, and to be a blessing to all the families of the earth, Genesis chapter 12 verse 3. You will fulfill this mission by doing justly, acting kindly, walking lightly, Micah chapter 6 verse 8, and not doing to others what you would consider hateful if it were done to you. Talmud Shabbat 31a. In this way, you and others like you work toward a fearless world without war. Micah chapter 4 verses 3 through 4, where people eat simply, drink moderately, work joyously, and love freely. Ecclesiastes chapter 2 verse 24, chapter 4 verses 8 through 12. In this world, people seek truth in their own way, bound together by shared questions rather than shared answers. Micah chapter 4 verse 5. Judaism without tribalism does not teach that Jews are God's chosen people, Deuteronomy chapter 14 verse 2, to whom he gave his one and only revelation, plus a perpetual deed to the promised land. It does not teach that this God is obsessed with Jewish foreskins, Genesis chapter 7 verses 10 through 14, Leviticus chapter 12 verse 3, or is addicted to animal sacrifice, Exodus chapter 20 verse 21, Numbers chapter 6 verse 14, chapter 28 verse 15, chapter 28 verse 30, chapter 29 verses 5 through 6 verse 11, or is jealous of every other god in the neighborhood, Exodus chapter 5 verse 9, chapter 20 verse 5, chapter 34 verse 14, Deuteronomy chapter 4 verse 24, chapter 6 verse 15, chapter 32 verse 16. Judaism without tribalism calls for revolution, or it calls for nothing at all. Jews are either or legoyim, a light unto the nations, Isaiah chapter 49 verse 6, or we are irrelevant. Our path is the iconoclasm of lech lecha, freeing ourselves from everything that keeps us from being a blessing to all the families of the earth, human and otherwise. Genesis chapter 12 verses 1 through 3. Our pedagogy is elu ve'elu, Eruvin 13b, honoring argument, doubt, and critical thinking over intellectual passivity, spiritual conformity, and manufactured consent. Our tools are Shabbat, liberating all beings from Mitzrayim, the narrow places of enslavement, and helping them reclaim their innate divinity, Deuteronomy chapter 5 verse 15, Exodus chapter 20 verses 8 through 10. Kashrut, elevating manufacturing and consuming to the highest ethical and environmental standards. Tzedakah, the just use of money and capital. Gemilut chasadim, the practice of loving kindness. Kavanot, setting our intentions toward righteousness. Shmirat halashon, cleansing our speech of gossip, slander, falsehood, and distortion. Lishmoa, listening to the divine hum of reality. Limud, turning Torah in search of wisdom. Let us teach our children to invent the future and not preserve a frozen and romanticized past. If we are not about the future, we will find that we have none. Part 1. Religion. Chapter 1. Religion at its best. Religion at its best honors the innate human drive to make meaning out of the chaos of reality. Religion at its worst is the institutional effort to impose specific meanings on reality. Religion at its best is intrinsically creative, fluid, and evolving. Religion at its worst is intrinsically imitative, nostalgic, and resistant to change. Religion at its best builds community based on common questions regarding the meaning and purpose of life. Religion at its worst imposes community based on enforced answers to these questions. Religion at its best is at home with doubt. Religion at its worst is at home with dogmatic or unquestioning belief. Religion at its best seeks to sharpen our questions. Religion at its worst seeks to silence our questioning. Religion at its best sees belief as a stepping stone to faith. Religion at its worst sees belief as a final truth. Religion at its best is a search for truth. Religion at its worst is the acquiescence to shared beliefs. Religion at its best is an act of inward searching. Religion at its worst is an act of outward conforming. Religion at its best is inherently dangerous in that it leads toward the unknown. Religion at its worst is safe in that it leads toward already accepted behaviors and beliefs. Religion at its best posits no beliefs. Religion at its worst insists upon them. Beliefs are affirmations of truth without any evidence that what is affirmed as truth is in fact true. For example, conventional Judaism believes that the Creator of the universe chose the Jews from among all the peoples of the earth to receive His one and only revelation, Torah, and the deed to the land of Israel. There is no evidence outside Jewish texts that this belief is true, and the insistence of Jewish texts that this is true is simply self-serving. Every religion posits such self-serving beliefs, and it is because there is no proof that any of these beliefs is true that people of different religions hold different and often opposing beliefs. The fact that many Jews believe themselves to be chosen does not make them chosen, any more than the fact that many Christians believe Jesus is the Son of God makes Jesus the Son of God. Think about this for a moment. Jews don't believe Jesus is the Son of God and reject as false the beliefs of those who do. This isn't an act of anti-Christian bias, but a reflection of the fact that beliefs aren't truths, but biases. Every religion confirms its own biases and rejects the biases of other religions. Religion at its best recognizes this to be the case and sheds its biases or beliefs, leaving one naked before the existential facts of reality, that we are all expressions of a wild, glorious, and chaotic process I call Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, a process capable of producing both light and dark, good and evil. Isaiah chapter 45, verse 7. Religion at its best needs no defense. Religion at its worst needs armies. Religion at its best welcomes testing, and those who test truth are called sages. Religion at its worst eschews testing and calls those who test beliefs heretics. Religion at its best honors the inner search for truth. Religion at its worst outlaws that search and makes truth a heresy. In this book, we will investigate Judaism as a religion at its best. Chapter 2. Religion and Death. Baruch Spinoza wrote, "The free person thinks least of all of death, and his wisdom is a meditation not on death, but on life." With all due respect to Spinoza, whom I regard as one of the greatest Jewish thinkers of all time, I think he has this exactly backwards. Indeed, I would even go so far as to suggest that it is thinking about death that ultimately leads you to be free. I say this because my own meditations on death, and life for that matter, have freed me from the illusion that I exist as a separate, temporarily embodied soul that existed prior to my birth and will continue to exist after my death. Think about this. If you are a disembodied soul prior to birth and will remain such after bodily death, what is the point of being embodied in the first place? What does the disembodied soul not know that the embodied soul can come to learn? And if there is something the disembodied soul needs to learn, I cannot help but wonder why this is. Why would God create ignorant souls? My understanding of life and death is best articulated in the metaphor of the ocean and wave. While each wave is unique and distinct, all waves are the happening of the ocean that waves them. No wave existed before the waving, and no wave exists after the waving. The ocean in this analogy is Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, the happening, happening as all happening. God, if you like. The wave is you. Just as a wave is the temporary happening of the ocean, so you are a temporary happening of God. When you die, you simply return to the source that waved you. Contemplating death as your return to your true nature as a happening of Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh is liberating. It frees you from having to cling to the temporary you and allows you to take refuge in the eternal divine. With this in mind, let's dive into the relation of religion and death. You are going to die. Maybe today, certainly tomorrow. There are two basic responses to this fact. Number one, holy shit, I'm going to die. And two, holy shit, I'm still alive. If you respond with the former, your energy is captured by death and how best to avoid it. If you respond with the latter, your energy is captured by life and how best to live it. Conventional religions avoid death by positing a personal afterlife. I'm not talking about the death of your body. Almost every religion accepts that, though some get around that by positing a return to your body in some future time. I'm talking about the death of your self, your personality, the you that you associate with your body regardless of the changes your body undergoes. If you believe that this you survives bodily death, if you believe you will have a life in some afterlife, if you believe in an eternal soul separate from all other souls that is uniquely you, you are avoiding death. Of course, I am aware that many, if not most, people do affirm such a soul. I simply ascribe this belief to the ego's need to imagine itself immortal. Sticking with my ocean/wave analogy, No wave outlasts its waving. This may be depressing to some, but not to me. To me, it is liberating. My true nature is the ocean, God, and my embodied self is simply an expression of God in time and space. Death simply returns me to what I already am. If, as I argue, avoiding death is the promise of conventional religion, then Judaism without tribalism focuses on living wisely with dying. If religion imagines that there is a way out of death, then Judaism without tribalism helps you to make meaning out of the life you have. Different religions deny death through various beliefs: heaven and hell, reincarnation, rebirth in other worlds or in other dimensions, but they all hold out the promise that you will not die a permanent death. Because we don't wish to die a permanent death, we imagine religions that promise us a way to escape death. The problem is this: with so many religions to choose from, and almost all of them offering a get-out-of-death-free card, how do you know which religion is the right religion? Which religion's get-out-of-death-free card actually leads to immortality? Pick the wrong one, and you die. Or worse, pick the wrong one, and you don't die, but spend eternity burning in hell. The challenge is to discern which religion is right about how to escape death. Sadly, there is no way to determine which religion is right. This is because all religions are based on beliefs, affirmations of truth that cannot be verified or falsified. Let me expand on this a moment. I live in a community dominated by evangelical Christians, almost all of whom believe I am going to hell because I do not accept Jesus as my Lord and Savior. They are certain they are right about this, and because their belief, like all belief, can neither be proven nor disproven, they may be right. Should I accept Jesus as my Lord and Savior just to be safe? When I put this option to rabbi friends of mine, they affirm that acceptance of Jesus is not the criterion necessary for access to heaven. How do they know? Their Jewish belief tells them so. But how do I know they are right? I could complicate matters even further and ask for the beliefs of my friends who are imams and swamis, but adding opinions doesn't solve my problem. Every religion asserts it is correct, but none can prove their assertion nor disprove the assertion of the others. Worrying about this will simply drive you crazy. There is a way out of this madness. Realize religions are competing clubs with their own self-serving beliefs and opt out of the game of trying to determine which one is true. This doesn't mean you have to stop being a Jew, a Christian, a Muslim, a Hindu, or anything else. It only means that you stop imagining that your chosen club is true. Judaism has no fixed notion of an afterlife. You can believe what you want about what happens after you die, including that nothing happens. Judaism simply isn't concerned with the afterlife. That's why our motto is L'chaim, to life. As the sage and heretic Baruch Spinoza wrote, "Free people think of death least of all. Their wisdom is a meditation not on death, but on life." Ethics, Part 4. The question Judaism asks isn't, how will you spend eternity after you die, but how will you spend the years you have before you die? That is the better question. Here is the question that will occupy us throughout this book. How shall we live the one life we have in a manner that fulfills our mission to be a blessing to all the families of the earth? Genesis chapter 12, verse 3. Chapter 3. God and Gods. What is true of gods is not true of God. As the creation of their tribe, a god is tasked with buttressing the power of tribal leaders and endorsing the policies these leaders seek to impose on other human beings. God is something else. Some people want a personal god for the same reason they want a personal lover, for the intimacy and the security. The problem with a personal god is the same as with a personal lover. You can never take that intimacy and security for granted. So, you are forever anxious. To earn your beloved's love, you agree to do whatever it is you imagine your beloved wants. When it comes to a personal God, however, all you know is what your God's professional spokespeople want you to know. These spokespeople are called theologians. Theologians are rarely free agents, and most theologians work for a specific God within a specific religion. Because each theologian works for one particular God, their ideas about God are always in service to that God. This is why Jewish theologians never discover that the Hopi are God's chosen people rather than the Jews, and why Christian theologians never discover that the Holy Trinity is Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva rather than Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Theologians only discover what they already believe to be true. This is confirmation bias masquerading as revelation. This is useful if you are promoting a specific God, but useless if you are seeking God beyond the gods of conventional religion. Of course, there are theologians who transcend religion. For example, Martin Buber's Eternal Thou Isn't Jewish and Paul Tillich's Ground of All Being Isn't Christian. But these are exceptions to the rule. Go to any library or bookstore and you'll find that the vast majority of books written by authors of one religion or another are promoting the God of their own religion. People routinely create gods in their own image for the purpose of securing their own status, power, and authority. Thus, the gods they create always prefer their creators and the descendants of their creators to other people. The status of a religion is proportionate to the power of its god to dominate other gods and their followers. The power of that god is directly related to the power of its army. This is why Judaism is a minor religion everywhere but in the state of Israel, where the Jewish God and his army reign supreme. God, as I use the word, refers not to any tribal deity or to any named god, but to the greater reality manifesting in, with, and as all being. God is not a noun, but a verb. As a verb, God cannot be owned by any tribe or authority, but as a noun, God is always owned. God as a verb is revealed to us through the parable of Moses and the burning bush, Exodus chapter 3, verses 1 through 15. In this story, Moses is shepherding his father-in-law's flocks, as he has done for decades. This time, however, he notices a bush on fire that is not consumed by the fire. Curious, Moses draws close to the burning bush and encounters God. Not the Israelite God, but God, the unnamed and fundamentally unnameable God. God tells Moses to remove his sandals because he is standing on sacred ground. Exodus chapter 3, verse 5. Sandals keep our feet from coming into direct contact with the ground. So in effect, God says to Moses, remove everything that keeps you from coming into direct contact with the ground of all being. In our own lives, this means removing any names we have for God, freeing ourselves from our tribal gods, and standing godless before God. This is something each of us must do if we are to realize truth. In tribalist Judaism, God is Adonai, Lord. But in Judaism without tribalism, God is Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, a variation of the Hebrew verb to be. The verb Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh lacks all vowels and is therefore literally unpronounceable. This is not an accident. Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh is the Tao that cannot be named, Tao Te Ching, chapter 1. If you cannot pronounce the name of God, you cannot reduce God to God, since all gods have pronounceable names. If you cannot reduce Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh to a god, Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh always points beyond the tribal to the universal. Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh is the God of all reality. Indeed, Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh is reality itself. An unnameable God is a God beyond the control of tribal leaders. Because Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh is beyond control, the early rabbis had to invent a God that was controllable. Since they inherited the name Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh from the Hebrew Bible, they couldn't simply abandon it. But since the name Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh was literally unpronounceable, they could create a euphemism that would in time replace Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh in the minds of the Jewish people and that could be placed in service of the rabbis. That euphemism was Adonai, Lord. Wherever the verb Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh appears in the Bible, the rabbis have ruled that the reader is to say Adonai instead. The god Adonai is male, hierarchical, and all about power and control. This suited the rabbis of emerging Judaism, who were also male, hierarchical, and all about power and control. When the rabbis translated the Hebrew Bible into Greek, the Septuagint, in the 3rd century BCE, they effectively wrote Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh out of the Bible by replacing the Hebrew verb Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh with the Greek noun Kyrios, which also means Lord. Later translations influenced by the Septuagint continued the practice, which is why English Bibles never speak of Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, but only of Lord. After removing his sandals, Moses experiences God commanding him to return to Egypt, Mitzrayim in Hebrew, and liberate the enslaved. Exodus chapter 3, verse 10. Mitzrayim is a Hebrew play on words meaning the narrow places. The unnamed and unnameable Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, the God beyond tribe and tribalism, is concerned with only one thing, human liberation. Knowing that people cannot easily grasp a God they cannot name, Moses asks God for a name. God, to avoid the tribalism that comes with a brand name God, replies with two, Ehiyeh Asher Ehiyeh, Exodus chapter 3, verse 14, and Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, Exodus chapter 3, verse 15. Neither name is a proper noun. Both names are verbs, variations of the Hebrew verb.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.